viewers. Today, in this lecture, we are going to discuss one of the important aspects of public administration, that is the principles of organization. For any organization, there are some principles needed to establish. Regarding the principles, there are two views prevailing among the scholars. In the opinion of the classical thinkers like Henry Fayol, Tyler, Luther Gulick, Lindahl Urwich and others, there should be definitely some basic principles needed for establishing any organizations. But the later thinkers who are emerging after the movement of human relations movement and other new developments of the public administration are of the opinion that there is no need of any principles for establishing the organizations. They used to call the principles as the proverbs or the myths for the organizations. But though different scholars differently numbering about the needed principle for establishing organizations, as Henry Fayol is of the opinion that there should be some 14 principles for establishing any organizations. Likewise, Luther Gulick and Lindahl Urwich are of the opinion that there should be some 7 principles in the name of Postcard, that is planning, organizing, staffing, directing, coordinating, reporting and directing. So there is no similarity of opinion among the scholars regarding the number of principles needed for establishing organizations. But all these scholars are of the opinion that there should be some at least 5 important principles needed for establishing organizations. They are the hierarchy, unity of command, span of control, delegation of authority, centralization and decentralization. Coming to the hierarchy. Hierarchy is a basic principle needed for establishing the organization. Hierarchy means it is the rule of the first principle is hierarchy. It is the rule of or control of the higher over the lower. It is also an organization with graded steps or levels in which each of the level is immediately subordinate to the next higher one. Now you are seeing the hierarchy in the figure. The hierarchy is a pyramidal structure. From top to bottom it is elaborating. In the top of the portion, the A which you are seeing is the chief executive. From A, B, C, D, E, it is elaborating from top to bottom in the hierarchy. Regarding the hierarchy, there are some basic principles underlying in establishing the hierarchy. There should be some superior subordinate relationship in the establishment of hierarchy. Secondly, there should be some effective controlling mechanism should be established in between the various subordinating units and the top level management. And thirdly, there should be communication channel should be established through proper channel. And these are the important basic principles should be established in the hierarchy. Coming to the merits of hierarchy, there are number of merits in the hierarchical system. First one is, as we are fixing responsibility and authority in the different levels of the organization, we are able to achieve a sort of clear-cut working mentality among the workers by avoiding confusion and chaos among the workers. Secondly, by establishing hierarchy, we are having a very good system of communication network from top to the bottom and to the bottom to the top. Thirdly, by hierarchy, we can able to establish a commanding and controlling system within the organization by properly controlling the various subordinate elements by sitting in the top level of the organization. Fourthly, the hierarchy is paving the way for delegation of authority by which the organization is able to achieve multi-dimensional nature of work by delegating various authority to different types of personalities. Coming to the demerits of hierarchy. Firstly, in the hierarchical system, delay is said to be the main demerit of hierarchy, because a file in the organization has to travel from a long way from top to bottom and from bottom to top to settle some things. So the delay which is caused by the hierarchy is paving way for red tapeism in the long run in the organizations. Secondly, when hierarchy is going to be extended for a very tall figure, then it will pave the way for losing touch by the chief executive to the various bottom level of the workers of the organization. Thirdly, in the hierarchical system, there is a missing of human relations in the relationship between the various levels of the organization, because everything is going to be considered only by positions. These are all some of the defects of the hierarchical system of the organization. But anyhow, even though these are all some of the defects, the hierarchy is a must for the modern organization, because every organizations are very large in the size in the modern administrative system. They have to take into consideration of innumerable levels and a multidimensional nature of work for the society. The second principle is unity of command. This, in any organization, it is to be said that by the scholars, there should be unity of command. That is, an employee should be placed in an organization in such a manner that he should receive orders from only one superior for a single nature of work. He should not be placed under two bosses. If it is placed under two bosses, there should be confusion, chaos in the part of the worker to whom he should be obey and which order he should carry out. Regarding the basic features of the unity of command, in the unity of command system, there is a proper control system established in the organization, and the workers are properly placed under the superior, and the command of the superior is rightly giving direction to the subordinates to work in a more smooth manner. But in the modern organizations, scholars like F.W. Diler is of the opinion that there is no possibility of establishing only one unity of command for any worker. For example, in an American organization, Diler used to say that for a single worker, there are 8 bosses controlling the single worker. In the figurative explanation, as you are seeing in the figure now, a single worker has been controlled by the gang boss, the speed boss, the inspector, the repair boss, the order of work clerk, instrumentation card clerk, the shop disciplinarian, and lastly, time and cost clerk. Thus, according to Diler, there are 8 bosses for a single worker in an American organization. With regard to the Indian context of example, a doctor who is working in a Panchayat Union office is immediately controlled by his administrative activities by the BDO. But at the same time, for his technical works, he has to report to the district medical officer who is working in the district level administration. There is no possibility of single unity of command in the modern organization, but it should be rightly taken that for a single nature of work, there should not be two bosses. For different nature of work, there may be different bosses according to the nature of work. Coming to the third principles, that is span of control. Span of control means a supervisor shall supervise as much subordinates as he can effectively supervise to carry out the task. Regarding the span of control, there are 5 determining factors that is deciding the span of control. Number 1 is the caliber of the supervisor. Number 2 is the age of the organization. 3rd is the nature of work. 4th is the morale of the workers. And last is the topography. Coming to the caliber of the supervisor, that if a supervisor is a most talented person and with the most efficiency in his nature of training, and he can ably supervise more and more number of subordinates than the ordinary supervisor who is inefficient. So the caliber of the supervisor who is going to supervise his subordinates is to be taken into account when we are fixing the span of control. Secondly, the age of the organization. If the organization is happened to be a very old organization with established procedures and rules within itself, then the span of control can be expanded and more and more number of subordinates should be put under one supervisor, because there is no need of giving explanation and direction very often to the subordinates. So if it is a new organization, then there is the span of control should be minimized, because the supervisor is happen to be give direction to all levels at all circumstances to the subordinates for all activities. So the age of the organization is the second important factor deciding the span of control of the organization. Third point is the nature of work. If the nature of work is routine, there is no need of supervisor's direction very often. Then in this case, the span of control can be expanded, more and more number of subordinates can be placed under the supervisor. But at the same time, if it is a heterogeneous nature of task, then the span of control should be minimized, because the supervisor is expected to give direction and closely watch to the heterogeneous nature of work by the subordinates. So the nature of work is the third deciding point in the deciding of the span of control in the organization. Fourthly, the morale of the workers. If the organization is having more number of workers of the organization are having a good morale, a feeling of patriotism towards the organization, then the span of control can be elaborated. There is no need of close supervision for those workers who are having more morale towards the organization. On the contrary, if the workers are not having a feeling of patriotism towards the organization, then the span of control should be minimized, because the supervisor is expected to give direction very often and is expected to give close watch to the workers during the working hours. This is the fourth principle to be taken into consideration when we are fixing the span of control. Coming to the fifth point, that is topography of the organization. If the subordinates who are placed under the supervisor are happen to be work under a single roof and in a single room, the supervisor can easily supervise the more number of workers. If they are happen to be placed in different places in the organization, then the span of control should be minimized, because the supervisor has to travel widely to supervise all the subordinates who are working under them. These are the five important features to be taken into consideration when we are fixing the span of control. The next principle is delegation of authority. Delegation of authority means adequate authority should be delegated to the subordinates for carrying out the jobs assigned to them. Delegated such authority should be in proportionate with the responsibility assigned to the subordinates. For every organization, there is a need for delegating authority to the subordinates. Any chief executive cannot be able to function all the needed functions for the organization. He has to delegate some of his functions to his subordinates on the basis of their ability and their efficiency. Without delegating authority, modern organizations cannot be effectively perform their functions. Regarding the delegation of authority, there are some important features you should take into account. Seeing the picture, there are the first feature is dual characteristics. Second is delegation to the position and not to the person. The third is delegation only from vested authority. And fourth is delegation of authority only after fixation of responsibility. And last is creation of obligation. Let us discuss one by one. Regarding the dual characteristics, that delegation of authority is not a single process. When the superior is delegating some authority to the subordinate, he is not delegating all the authority to the subordinates. When delegating some authority under his superior, he is keeping some of the powers under him. Whenever he happened to watch, subordinate is not going on the line in which he has been given direction to finish the task, he can again take the authority from him and he can entrust the authority to another personality. So it is not a full delegation, it is only a partial delegation, it is a dual characteristics delegation. The authority has been remaining in both the superior and the subordinates. coming to the second point, that is delegation of authority to the position and not the person. That is, when the superior is delegating authority to the subordinates, he should not delegate the authority to a person. He should delegate the authority only on a position, that is the manager to the assistant manager and superintendent, like that of in a position only the superiors delegate the authority. They should not delegate the authority to the person whom they wanted, whom they are most liked. Because in the organization, when we are delegating authority, it should be based on only positions and not persons. The third point is delegation only from vested authority. That is, when the superiors delegating authority to the subordinates, he should not delegate authority to the subordinates which he has not possessing. Only the vested authority can be delegated to the subordinates. The authority which the superior himself is not possessing cannot be entrusted to the subordinates. The fourth is delegation of authority only after fixation of responsibility. That is, when the superior delegating authority to the subordinates, he should necessarily fixing certain responsibility. Without fixing responsibility, if we are delegating authority means, then the subordinates can the possibility of misusing the authority on his own will and wish pleasure. So whenever we are delegating authority to the subordinates, the superior should necessarily taking into account by fixing certain clear-cut responsibilities in the part of the subordinates. In the delegation of authority, the fifth important factor is creation of certain obligations in the part of the subordinates by the superiors. These are the important aspects to be taken into consideration when delegating the authority to the subordinates. The next point is centralization and decentralization. In any organization, there is a need for centralizing the organization or decentralizing the organization on the basis of the organization function. The meaning of centralization and decentralization. Centralization and decentralization are the process through which the decision-making powers are vested in a single authority or distributed with a number of authorities in the organization. There are five important factors determining the factor of centralization and decentralization in the organizations. Number one, the factors of responsibility. Number two, the stability of the organization. Number three, the functional aspects. Number four, the personal factors. Number five, the external conditioning. Let us discuss one by one the important determining factors of organization. Number one, the factors of responsibility. That is, in the organization, the responsibility of accepting the success and failure of the particular task is resided in the chief executive. The third factor of deciding centralization and decentralization of the organization is the functional aspects. If the organization is happened to perform services to the larger areas and very remote areas of the nation, that organization should be decentralized. If some organizations are happen to perform a minimum function to the limited area, then organizations can be centralized. So the nature of function is another factor of deciding the centralization or decentralization for the organizations. The next point is personal factors. The next point is personal factors. That is, the persons who are happen to work in the very regional areas are very loyal to the central organization and they are very much efficient in finishing the task. Then on the basis of the personal ability, there is a possibility of decentralizing or decentralization of administration. But if the persons or the regional units are not having such kind of loyalty and such kind of affiliation towards the central organization, then that organization should be centralized and all the direction should be come from only center. The next point is external conditioning. The external condition means the other organizations which are competition to the particular organization are eagerly expecting for doing certain damage to the organization, then at the time the organization should be centralized. If the organization is not having any competition, any danger from the external, then that organization can be easily decentralized. These are the five important factors to be taken into consideration of making the organization with the centralization and decentralization. So far, we had discussed the five important principles of organization, namely hierarchy, unity of command, span of control, delegation of authority, and centralization and decentralization. By adopting these important five principles in the organization can attain economy and efficiency, and it can perform very well. Thank you.